Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today I'm speaking with Lex Gillette. Lex is a Paralympic athlete with 5 Paralympic medals. He has 4 world championship titles, and he's the current world record holder in long jump for totally blind athletes. It's a fascinating conversation. We talk about his book that came out just before the pandemic. His next book is ready to come out at the end of the year. Lots to talk about. I hope you enjoy the conversation. Hi, Lex. It is so great to spend some time with you. I'm really looking forward to our conversation.
Absolutely. No, I'm glad to be here, for sure.
So I'm going to assume that a lot of people listening don't know who you are. I mean, how could they? How could they not know who you are? But, you know, you are... I can call you an elite athlete. You're an elite athlete. You're a Paralympian. You, when I looked at your website, it was like gold, 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 silver, silver, gold, 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 silver, silver. It's like you have won a ton of awards. Maybe when somebody asks you to explain who you are or what you do, what do you tell them?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a Paralympic track and field athlete, so I compete in the sport of track and field, specifically the long jump, and also run the 100 meters as well. So it's, you know, it's a lot of fun. I get to do what I love to do. I get to work with some amazing people. And of course, with me being blind, I have a guide who I spend a lot of time with on the track. So he's helping me to train and compete. And it's fantastic.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm definitely lucky to do what I get to love.
You also, are you not the current world record holder for the long jump?
Yes.
For totally blind athletes.
Yes. Yes, yes, wow. Yes. So the record is 22 feet, 1 inch.
22 yeah. feet? Yeah. Oh my gosh. What? I had no idea. 22 feet?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, this is why you're a track and field athlete and I'm not. My goodness. Okay. So let's go back in time to when you were born and you had trouble with your retinas. Is that what happened?
Yeah. So once I had gotten to be 8 years old, I started having issues with retina detachments. And that led to a string of 10 operations that I had on my eyes to try and fix the issue. After the last one, doctors basically, they said that they couldn't do anything else to help my sight. And they said that I would eventually become blind. So from there, it was, you get the news. And then over a few months, it is a gradual decrease until one day you wake up and you can't see anything.
So who did you grow up with? Both parents, single parent, siblings?
Yeah, my mom. Yeah, my mom. So she's been the one who has engineered basically a lot of the success that I've experienced in my life, which is awesome.
Yeah, yeah. So tell me a little bit about your mom. Your mom's name is Verdina?
Yep. Her name is Verdina. She is back in North Carolina. So I'm here in San Diego, California. I live and train here for the Paralympics, and my mom and family, they're back in North Carolina. So it was my mom and I growing up, and prior to me losing my sight, we would go outside and have a good time, play around, and you know, my mom would walk me to we had like a nearby park that wasn't, you know, that was a lot of fun to go hang out. We used to, you know, rip and run up the street. Because we lived in close proximity to a lot of different stores, restaurants, et cetera, et cetera. So my mom is actually, she has glaucoma, so she's visually impaired as well. And so she felt like it was necessary that we be in an area where we don't necessarily have to depend on everyone all the time, asking for rides, asking for assistance, et cetera, et cetera. So, yeah, we were always around grocery stores, retail stores, restaurants, things like that. So, you know, if you ever need to get out and about, you can do those things on your own.
Right, right. So yeah. You were 8 when you, were you 8 years old when you lost your sight?
You know what? But I think by the time I was nine, I really, you know, everything was basically gone in terms of the eyesight. So, you know, I had that last operation, but there was still a period of time where the sight gradually, you know, each day it was decreasing. Right. So,
and I, you know, it's interesting because I on your website you have the hashtag Ask Lex. And I watched a bunch of them, and I really like them. I like that people can write in and ask you questions, and there's some really interesting questions. And one of the stories you told that I really connected to was about your grandmother and the garden hose and how she set that up.
Oh, yeah.
And, I mean, it just, to me, it sounds like you were surrounded by two really incredible women who, you know, really helped you achieve great things and independence and but the garden hose, can you tell us that story?
Yes. So the garden hose at my grandma's house, she has this really huge backyard. And so we would go outside and it was nothing for the family to have, you know, a ball, a kickball or something. So there's always some sort of sport, some sort of activity going on in the backyard, hide and seek, all of those types of things. And so we had the garden hose, which was on the side of my grandma's house. When I would go out in the backyard and, you know, be doing flips and cartwheels and things like that, my grandmother would take the garden hose and spread it out in the backyard. So she would stretch it from the side of the house into the backyard. I would be able to know how to navigate back to the home because I would get to where the garden hose is, and I would basically walk and feel the texture of the garden hose under my feet, and that would guide me back to the home. So I could be out in the backyard playing around, running around. And I always knew that as long as I can make it to the garden hose, then that'll lead me back to my grandma's house, and I can, you know, go inside, go indoors. Mm-hmm.
I just thought it was such a sweet story, and really, I mean, it sounds like they're two pretty amazing women in your life, your grandma and your mom. Yeah. So growing up in, you grew up in North Carolina. And I mean, was school hard? What was it like going to school? And what was it like? Like, what did you have a perfect childhood? I don't know. Like, I did. You, your mom and your grandma.
Yeah,
sound nice.
Like, what is a perfect childhood?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Does it exist?
That's a good question. I don't know if I would say that school was easy or hard. I think you just have the, you know, it's school. So you have your experiences that you go through. And for me, being blind as well, definitely presented some challenges, but I had some amazing people in my life. And of course you talked about my mom and my grandma. I also have some amazing teachers as well, who they knew the expectations of my mom. And, you know, she definitely made it known that, hey, when my son leaves the house and he's at school, he still needs to be doing this and that and, you know, that and the third. And so I want to make sure that everyone holds him accountable. He has to turn his homework in just like everyone else. He has to do this. He has to do that. I don't want anyone to have any type of pity on him just because that he's blind. Like, at the end of the day, once he goes into the world, he is going to live independently and is going to need to survive on his own, excuse me. And this is going to put him in the best position to succeed. So yeah, school was definitely, it was fun. It was, you know, it was challenging at times. And, but I mean, you know, at the end of the day, it certainly provided a lot of experiences that have helped me in life. So, yeah, I loved high school.
Yeah.
High school was probably my favorite.
Oh, there you go. So at what point though, Lex, did you find out or discover that you were good at running and long jump, and you were an athlete.
I found out. So I've always been an athletic person. I mentioned that my mom's side of the family, that's the athletic side. So my mom has played basketball, softball, my aunties, uncles, cousins, you know, they've played all of the sports. So I've always been pretty athletic. And prior to me losing my sight, I used to play rec league baseball. Also used to swim as well. And once I had lost my sight, it was just a matter of being able to transition from once being able to see the sport or a sport and now not being able to see it, but still figuring out a way to make it accessible so that I could still participate. So a lot of it started when I was in high school. But what really helped me is just like navigating around in general, like walking around my neighborhood, being able to navigate around my school, knowing how to get from classroom to gym, gym to cafeteria, all of those types of things. That really helped to build my confidence so that when I actually did get introduced to track and field, although it was scary and it was challenging, I had a certain level of confidence that I could bring to the table. And that was built because of, you know, me being able to navigate in other spaces safely and successfully. But learned about long jump in high school. I had a teacher who taught me about the sport and told me about the Paralympics and being able to travel the world and win medals and represent Team USA. And yeah, I mean, it was...
Sounded good.
Definitely a dream at that time, yeah.
So how old were you when you, I guess, technically ran or competed in your first competition?
Oh, I would probably say I might have been like 15 or 16.
So you were young.
So yeah, I was definitely really young.
And were you running when you did that? So who were you running for in school? Were you doing it in school?
Yeah. Yep. I was on my high school track team. So Athens Drive High School, Jaguars. And yeah. Yep.
So how does that work though, Lex? So you're in high school, you're 15, 16. You wanna compete in track and field. You're blind. You need assistance to help you do it, right? And so what does that assistant do? Like, what? Tell me how that works.
Yeah, in the long jump, they're standing at the takeoff point, the takeoff board, so they're clapping and yelling, so that gives you an audible reference as to where you need to run and jump from. Whether you can see or not, as a jumper, long jump, triple jump, high jump, pole vault, a lot of those athletes know how many strides it takes in their approach. So their run up to the jump. So I knew that I needed to take a certain amount of steps. So we decided what that number would be. It started off something small in the beginning, maybe like 8 strides or something. Right now I go from 16 strides. So I know that on my 16th step, I should be in the takeoff zone, the takeoff area. So my guide is standing there. He's clapping, yelling as loud as possible. I'm running at the sound of his voice, straight as possible, fast as possible. On my 16th step, that's when I jump, soar through the air. Now, when we're not participating in the long jump, when we're just purely training, trying to get my speed right, trying to get stronger, faster, he's actually running beside me on the track itself. So when we do the 100 meter repeats or the 150 meter repeats, running up the hills, he's literally right next to me, making sure that I stay in the correct lane or stay in the correct area so I won't get hurt.
Wow. So he's in good shape too.
Yeah. Yes. Definitely got to have somebody who's in shape.
Oh, wow. Okay. So at 22 feet, if that's the record and you hold it, what does it feel like flying through the air?
It happens so quickly.
Yeah.
It happens really fast. And I mean, just the thought of, I mean, you're on this runway, you're running as fast as you can without being able to see. And at this, at a certain point, you propel yourself through the air. It's exhilarating. It's invigorating. Definitely. It's a satisfying feeling. I think that, you know, just literally being able to physically jump that far is, you know, it's really cool.
Yeah.
But I
would say so. And exhilarating is such a great way to describe it too. And also, it must have been terrifying when you were first starting out to just sort of take that leap without seeing.
Yeah. And certainly as with all things, you're faced with a challenge, a task that seems really daunting, and you are in this space where you feel, you know, you feel a little frightened at times.
Yeah.
And wonder how you might be able to achieve it. But I'm pretty sure I definitely felt a lot of those things when I first started, but I had Mr. Whitmer there, who was my teacher, and he was the one who really let me know that, hey, nothing is going to happen here. You have this stretch of track that is in front of you. If you veer to the left, if you veer to the right, you're not going to run into anything. This is flat ground. You're not going to run into a pole or anything like that. So just give it your best. I'm here. I'm going to make sure that you are safe. I'm going to give you the audible cues that you need, and we're going to make this happen.
It's incredible. And you're primarily long jump, and you also run, and you have 5 Paralympic medals. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is amazing. When was your first Paralympics?
2004.
Wow. So were you terrified?
Yeah,
'cause I would imagine going to a Paralympic Games would be, I mean, it's the best in the world.
It's a different environment. You're inside this huge stadium. Definitely the butterflies, a little bit of nervousness, but once you start to move around, run around a little bit, all of those things start to subside. It was that first time walking inside of the stadium, hearing all of the cheers and knowing that you just worked 3-4 years of your life to have this one moment in time. It's a special moment for sure. And that first time, you know, I'll never forget that first one.
I bet. And so you're obviously with Team USA. And I forgot to mention that, Team USA. And you are a fierce competitor. So when you are with your other teammates and if there are other younger athletes coming up, like, I'm going to guess that you had your mentors, and I'm going to guess that you probably mentor people also.
Yeah, definitely try to share the things that I've learned over my career. I've had, definitely had a lot of people who helped me within the athletic space and outside of the athletic space too. I mean, you need mentors, you need allies and guides and people in your corner so that you can go out into the world and achieve the things that you want to achieve. So with all of the things that I've been fortunate enough to experience in and around the sport of track and field, I definitely want to mentor and pass down whatever I can to the athletes who are coming up, because if it has been this amazing for me, I can only imagine what it will be for them as things continue to evolve. So, I definitely want them to experience a lot of awesomeness within the sport, but also being able to catapult from the sport and, you know, figure out how they might be able to use, all of the skills and things that we learn within the sport. And how can you leverage those things into that next phase of life? So, yeah, however I can help, I'm definitely, you know, wanting to be that person who can help for sure.
Yeah, well, we all need somebody, right? We all need a mentor. We all need somebody who's traveled that road before us. So on the show, Lex, what we like to do is we like to thank our guests for their time. And so we ask our guests to choose a registered Canadian nonprofit to give $500 to. And you chose Classroom Champions, which is an organization that pairs Olympians, Paralympians, and professional athletes to for students in schools in underserved areas in the U.S. and everywhere. And you work with them a lot, don't you?
Yes. Yep. So we do. We actually, the majority of the schools that I mentor, of course, are in the United States, but we have Canadian mentors as well, and the program is very prominent within Canada. So, as a side note, I haven't had a chance to actually go up. The headquarters is in Calgary, I believe, and I haven't been able to go up there and visit yet.
Well, you will. There has been a pandemic. It's been a little hard to do, right?
Right. But Steve, who started Classroom Champions, he's a bobsledder. So I'm assuming that the bobsled community is huge in Canada and probably in Calgary. I would imagine that the weather during the wintertime is conducive to having some great slides down the slopes.
I've actually been in that indoor one in Calgary. They have an indoor bobsled.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I did it one time when we had the Olympics here in Vancouver. We had the Winter Olympics and Paralympics here in 2010.
What was that like going down the slope?
It was terrifying. But you know what was more terrifying? The outfit you have to wear, because it's like that skin tight.
I hate being cold. So I already know, like, competition days for bobsledders, I would imagine it's freezing. But when you got, you have adrenaline going and things like that. So I would imagine that they're totally fine. Yeah. Classroom Champions, it's great. I've been a part of the program for 7-8 years and actually recently just got elected to the board of directors.
Oh, so congratulations. That's great.
It'll be awesome to kind of be on the opposite side of the coin and figuring out how we can continue to help the students who we serve around the globe.
Yeah, no kidding. So, moving forward, you're also a motivational, speaker, you're a keynote speaker. People hire you all the time to come and speak to their groups. Do you like doing that? Do you like speaking?
Yes. Yeah, definitely. It's a lot of fun. And ironically, growing up, I didn't speak much. I think a lot of it was just dealing with the insecurities around losing eyesight, and you're going through school, and sometimes students are saying these things or those types of things. And yeah, you're just going through that young human experience at that time. And I think once I got a little older and realized that, you know what, when you're on these stages and you're in front of these groups, it's really not about you. It's about the people who are sitting in the audience. And that helped to really shift my thinking to the point of, who cares if, people are looking at me, or who cares if, this is happening or that is happening. The main goal here is to help positively impact people's lives. And so if I can use my story in a way that will help others, let's do it.
Yeah. And it's a really important, point you just made, that when you are in school and if you have a difference, right, if you have a disability, kids can be really mean, and it can be high school or elementary school can be great, and it can also be really horrible for some people. So to see other people succeeding and then hearing, someone like you talk about your experience and that you've been through the same things, and now, it's just to see the possibilities is so powerful.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, all of those times, like being in school, the friends that I had, the teachers who I had, it wasn't perfect by any means, but all of the experiences that I had have definitely helped to shape and mold a lot of the things that I've been able to experience in life, which is really cool.
So what happens when, you just I don't know, your body is like, we're not going to do any more long jump, Lex. We're not going to do any more. Then what happens? What do you do? What's your plan? I know you're not thinking about that right now because you just got home from practice, didn't you? From training.
Was not long ago. What do you do when it's all said and done? I think that, so for me, I want to continue to speak. I have another book that's coming out the latter part of this year. So I'm really excited about that. That should be a lot of fun. Continue to speak, and I don't know, who knows, just live life and have a lot of fun. As long as I can pay my bills and keep a roof over my head, I think I should be good. But I mean, definitely, you know, the time is approaching where, you know, I have to think about these things. Like, I've been doing this since 2004, and it's been, 18 years? Like, it's literally half of my life. So it's slowly coming to that point where it's like, all right, well, I'm gonna hang the shoes up at one point, but I think I'll be good.
I think you'll be just fine. Do you feel it in your body now, though, Lex? Like, do you feel... like, you know, after, you know, a competition or whatever it might be, big training session, do you feel your age, I guess, or do you still feel great?
I still feel young. I don't feel like I'm 21. I don't feel like I'm 21 anymore, but yeah, I mean, you know, I wake up sometimes and, you know, I might be tight in, you know, certain muscles, or I might not be able to roll out of bed and just get up and go the way I used to when I was 23 years old.
I don't, but you feel good.
I'm not able to. Yeah. Like, I'm good enough to do what I need to do. And that's all that really matters.
So wait a second. You just told us that you have another book coming out. You wrote a book and it came out in February of 2020, right before the pandemic started. So what was that like, writing a book, getting it published, putting it out there in the world? What was that like?
It was definitely a process. It was a lot of things that I have written in the past, like blog entries. And so what we did was we took a lot of those things that I had written in the past. I also did a lot of recording on my mobile phone. So I would use the audio recording, and I would talk out a lot of my thoughts and the things that I wanted to, that I wanted the reader to experience within the book. And so work with the editor to get all of those things transcribed. And they also, you know, helped to piece the book together in a way where it, you know, it, like, it flows, mm-hmm, it, mm-hmm. It's, you know.
But you obviously the experience because you're writing another book.
Yeah. No, that first time it was, you know, it was me getting my feet wet and, you know, going through the publishing process and things like that. It was smooth for the most part.
Yeah. Well, listen, it's not easy to write a book. Well, yeah. What is your second book about?
Yeah. This one is, so it's called No Need for Sight When You Have a Vision. That's kind of my mantra that has helped me catapult into, you know, all of these awesome things. And so this one, No Need for Sight When You Have a Vision, and the subtitle is What Blindness Can Teach Us About Risk and Leadership. So it's speaking to a different audience. The first book was more so, it'll probably come across as a memoir. It wasn't my intention for it to be a memoir, but, you know, talking about my life, but also being able to pull lessons from that. So in the first one also, anybody can read that. You know, if you're 10 years old, you can get something from it. If you're 60 years old, you can get something from it. This one, I would say, is more so geared toward like that leader within and really transcending beyond what your, you know, what your eyes mm-hmm. see, and catapulting yourself into mm-hmm. an amazing vision.
No kidding. Well, I look forward to reading it. So it comes out later this year, you're hoping, or for sure it is.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I'll have to make sure I send you one, for sure.
Now I'll go to the bookstore and buy it. You know what, Lex? It's been such a joy talking to you. And I'm just looking at your Instagram right now. And I don't know who is doing your Instagram, if you're doing it yourself, but it is so good. The photos of you are incredible, and just seeing the work that you're doing and how powerful you are on the track. And I mean, I really have a hard time using the word inspirational. Like, I don't really, I find that word really interesting. How do you feel about that word, inspirational?
That's a very good question, and especially given as a person with a disability, that word makes people cringe. I personally don't have a problem with the word inspiration. I think that when I think about inspiration, I think about being able to, like, you're going into the world and you're wanting to do awesome things, and inspiration is kind of like that. It's like that fuel or that gas. And you see other people doing awesome things, and it's like, dog, like that's really amazing. Like that's inspiring. I want to do that as well. And so when I think about inspiration, there's action attached to it. It's just not, oh, okay, well, you're inspiring. Like, right. Oh my gosh, you know how to bend down and tie your shoes. All right, good job. Like that's useless. I think that it's more along the lines of, all right, like this is inspiring, and how can I use this to help elevate the things in my life, or how can I use this to help elevate someone else's life and the things that they are dealing with in their human experience. So, there's always, it's because, like, the reality is, like, inspiration and motivation. And I'm still kind of like we know speakers as you hear the word motivational speaker, and I don't know how I necessarily feel about that title. Obviously, I love the job, and I love doing it. But the reality is too, like you can be motivated right now, and then 30 minutes later, you can not be motivated at all. I mean, you can feel bad, you can feel frightened, you can feel overwhelmed, all these types of things. And so I think the most important piece, again, going back to the inspiration, is really tapping into that inspiration with the goal of having some sort of action that you can apply to your own individual life, or again, or to others. So
once again, another good point. I didn't really look at it that way. I guess I'm so used to seeing, you hear so many people now talk about inspiration porn, right? Where it's somebody with a disability does something that is completely, typical, goes to prom or goes to whatever it might be, and it's inspirational. And it's it's not inspirational, actually. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I like the way that you position that, because it is inspiring to see somebody chase their dream and achieve and do well, and you know what I mean? Work hard.
Yeah. And it's like, it's tough too, because for the person who doesn't have a disability and they use that term, a lot of times people just don't know. And I think that as a person within the disability community, knowing that word, like, that's a trigger word for a lot of people with a disability. I think my thing is just really being able to just have some conversation around it. Like, I don't feel like anybody should be deterred from using that word. I just think that, just being a little mindful as to, how you use it.
Isn't that the
like
truth?
Like I was, you know, like you just mentioned, going to prom is not like it's a big deal,
but it's not inspiring.
But it's not a big deal.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
I like the way you position that, Lex. Such a joy. Okay, your first book is called
Fly.
Your second book, Does it have a name yet or no?
Yep, no need for sight when you have a vision.
Oh, yeah, right. You just told me that. Awesome. I can't wait. Your website is Lex, L-E-X, Gillette, G-I-L-L-E-T-T-E.com. And you're also on Twitter and Instagram at Lex Gillette. Thank you so much for your time. I really, really enjoyed our conversation, Lex.
Likewise. I appreciate it. Thank you for having me on.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.